Amen.
Thank you, brother.
I love that song, Sinking Deep. You know you can't find the bottom of God's love, right? It has no bottom. You just got to keep sinking deeper and deeper. Amen. That's a beautiful song. Well, anybody make any New Year's resolutions, or did you start the year strong, or are you already saying, oh, man? It's January 5th. We're already saying, oh, man. That's all right, man. The just man falls seven times, but he shall rise again. Just get back up. Just get back up. Amen. But we had a great time New Year's Eve. It was, I think it was wonderful. We shared in the table of life, if you were here. We had a wonderful time of fellowship in the back and fireworks, and I truly did enjoy the evening. I thought it was really a very special evening. And I'd like to maybe continue to pick it up from some of the things that we touched on New Year's Eve. You know, we talked about, you know, the bread and the wine, and we talked about life, and of course, you know, also greater vision. I believe, you know, Sister Trick, you mentioned that as well. Even, and Ken, you as well. And I do believe that, you know, I do believe God will continue to reveal things. There's got to be greater vision. And of course, it's the vision of faith. You know, faith has eyes. Faith also has ears. Faith comes by hearing. Doesn't the Bible say that? Well, that means faith has ears. Faith also has a voice, church. The Bible mentions the voice of heaven several times in Genesis, all the way through Revelations. And so heaven has to have a voice too. And I believe when we have greater vision, we have greater hearing, I believe then there'll be the voice of heaven. Amen. I believe there'll be the voice of heaven. So the passage of scripture I'd like to look at this morning, and I'll be in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. Most of you know I generally read from the King James. And Brother Keith will probably help us if you don't have a Bible. Feel free to look at the overheads. If you need a Bible, ask my brother and I. We'd be more than happy to give you a Bible. And I do believe there is life in his word. Amen. But I'll start in verse 1. I'm not sure how much all this will clear, but I do believe there's some messages in here. And I believe that 7 is actually talking about the voice of heaven. Okay, so there you go. I just gave you the summary. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, it's talking about the voice of heaven. And it starts off, a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. And, you know, the good name, it's the good name is always Christ. You know, actually, you said it, Sister Sandy, you know, in Ephesians, that we're looking to become the perfect man. The perfect man is the Christ man. You know, and it's more precious than ointment. You know, an ointment, you know, again, it's just talking about the temporary. But it says that the day of the death is better than the day of one's birth. Which, you know, you always find these oxymorons in the Bible, and it's like, is the day of me dying really better than the day of me being born? Well, I guess it just depends on how you look at life, church. But I believe, of course, you know, again, his word has got to be true. It's got to be right. Amen? And I believe we've got to look at this through spiritual eyes to really understand what he's talking about. I don't believe he wants us to die necessarily. But he does want us to die to self. I do believe he's talking about the new birth. It's the birth of the spirit man, and that's why that day is better. It's a better day. It's, you know, it's Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives within me. Amen? So we're talking about the Christ man. I die to myself, and now it's the Christ man that has now been birthed inside of me. It comes alive in me. And what causes it to do that? Well, he just awakened it. Faith. Faith awakens it, okay? Not my natural senses, not my reasoning, not my logic. It's just faith. It's faith in God, amen? But that's what he's talking about here, and that is, you know, that is the good name, you know? And a lot of folks, you know, want to have a good name, or, you know, you'll be known for a person of character, amen? Right? One of the greatest speeches ever given by Martin Luther King, right? You know, that we, what? That the content of our character, not the color of our skin. Listen, he was a preacher. I mean, where do you think he got that from? The Word. He's just preaching God, okay? Now, the whole world benefited from it, amen? Why wouldn't it? It's the Word of God. It has to. But he knew it was the Christ man. I believe that. I believe he knew it was The Christ man. That was the content that he was talking about. That was the character that he was talking about. Amen. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. For that is the end of all men. And the living will lay this to heart. What will I lay to heart? That I know that in order for me to, for this Christ man to be birthed, that I might have to go through some stuff. It's not going to be found in the joy and the laughter. Not that we shouldn't have joy and laughter. We do. I believe we do have joy and laughter. But I believe as we go through these experiences, that then you will find, you'll lay it to heart. You'll understand. There'll be, it's based on faith. It's always the heart of faith. Not reason and logic, because reason and logic will say, well, that doesn't make any sense. No, it will never make sense, right? The things of the spirit will never make sense in the flesh, and the flesh will never make sense of the spirit, right? That's why you got to live a spirit-filled life, not a natural life. It's not that we're not living and breathing. I just quoted Galatians 2. Yes, you are living and breathing, but it's the Christ that's inside of you that is living and breathing, amen? But it says that it's the end of all men. All men. All men is all men. All men will experience this. We just don't understand it. And we think that, well, it's not quite the same. It's the same for everybody. Amen. I know you feel like you've got a special house of mourning, which is essentially a trial, a tribulation, whatever you want. Newsflash, you don't. It's the same. Paul actually talked about that in Corinthians. He said that your temptation, it's not, you know, it's not like we're tempted, like any attempted to have ice cream. That's not what he said. It's talking about a trial. That it is common among man. What is it? It's common. It's common. Now, yes, you're special in the eyes of God. Yes. Your trial is not special. Your trial don't make you special. It's common among men. How common is it? You're all going to go through it. It's common. Everybody's got it. Now, I don't know what your trial is. I don't know what your house of mourning is. I don't know. I have one. Actually, I have more than one. You might have more than one. You say, Pastor, I got 1,000. Maybe. It's still common. However God chooses to get you there, I don't know. I don't know how he chooses to get there. Every man in his own order. Paul also said that. What's every man in his own order? Every man in his own order that he'll bring about the Christ inside of you. But you got to see this spiritually. You got to understand that it's just God that's working in your life. Amen? And that's essentially what he's talking about here. Sorrow is better than laughter. But by the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better. What did it do to me? What it did was it changed my countenance. It changed my appearance of what? My heart. Now you actually see the reflection of my heart. Because before I hit it up, I wasn't going to show you. What broke it down? The house of mourning, the trial. He just to break it down. So now that you will see the true reflection of my heart, which is Christ. Looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Joy was set before him. That's why he endured the cross. It wasn't for sin, by the way. It was for the joy that was set before him that he endured the cross. Joy. Who was set before him? Well, if we read the account of Jesus on the cross, there was the Roman soldier that put the nails in his hands. He was set before him. There were the four Marys and John. They were set before him. The Sanhedrin, the very church folk that put him up there to begin with, they were before him. The joy that was set before him, the Roman soldier, the Marys, the Sanhedrin, the joy that was set before him endured the cross, the people that was set for before. Why do you endure the cross? Because of the people in my life. I endure the cross. Now there's the reflection of my heart. That was, if you can see this church today, if you can see this, you need greater vision. Maybe the cross was the reflection of his heart upon who? Humanity, including the Roman soldier, including the Sanhedrin, and yeah, the four Marys. The joy that was set before him endured the cross. It's faith. What did it do? It changed my heart. It changed the countenance of my heart. You can now see it. It's now the reflection in my life. It's got to be reflected in my life. If I don't reflect Christ in my life, it's hidden. Didn't he say that? And Paul also said that those that don't understand it, the gospel is hidden to them. Why? Well, because they haven't reflected it yet into their life. The gospel is supposed to be a light to what? All men. All is all. Anybody read scriptures like that? Yeah, it's supposed to be a reflection. But this really is our identity. That's what he's talking about. This, you're actually now, your true identity comes about through this process. Amen? You understand what I'm saying? It's just like when in the Navy, we used to have to polish our brass. I know my dad used to do this too, maybe some of you military guys. Well, the first thing they used to tell us to do, because I didn't know, and someone had to tell me, you burn the brass. You would actually burn it, get everything out of it, and you'd take the lighter and burn it off. And then you would buff it, buff it, and buff it, and buff it, and scrub it, and buff it, and buff it. And what happened? You could get that thing like glass. You could literally look at it and be glass. But how did I go through? Well, first I had to apply some heat, and then I had to buff it. That's what God does with us. He applies some heat, which is just the love of God, amen? Amen. And then he might have to buffet you. No, just me. You guys are all good. But why? Only so he can change your countenance so you can be the reflection of Christ. So the gospel not be hid. The gospel's got to come out of you and I, amen? That's what Solomon's talking about here. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of the fools is in the house of myrrh. The heart of the fools, listen, he just wants to, I don't want no tough times. That's me. When I don't want no tough times, I'm just a fool. It's like the Doobie Brothers. What a fool believes. A fool will believe some stuff. I'm just a fool, though. He didn't call me a sinner. He just said, I'm just foolish. I'm just immature. I'm a child. I'm whatever. Because I don't want to go through that. What kid wants to go to a doctor? Hey, we're going. I don't want to go. He's going to give me a needle. I'm just childish, man. I'm just childish. It is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than a man that hears songs of fools. Yeah, sometimes you need just correction. Sometimes I just need correction. Again, it's not like we get, anybody got life all figured out? Yeah. No, it's just correction. And again, the fool says, I don't want to be corrected, right? The wise man says, well, you know what? There might be more to this life. There might be greater vision. There might be greater hearing. There might be a voice from heaven. Amen? So maybe God can do that for us. Verse 6. For as the crackling of the thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This is also vanity. I thought, when I read this, I thought of that song by Foreigner. You're as cold as ice and willing to sacrifice our love. See, that's me. I'm the fool. I'll make a fire. It's going to burn real fast. How fast? Like, poof, it's gone. Ain't going to produce much warmth now, is it? I mean, I'll make a lot of noise. I love you. What happened to that love? Oh, it faded fast because I'm cold as ice. Jesus Christ said that. He said that the iniquity abounds because your love for many has waxed cold. You see, and unfortunately, at times we choose to see sin, the iniquity abounds, instead of me just loving you. My love has waxed cold. Why? Because I didn't have greater vision. I chose to see your sin instead. And now I don't love you. That's what the fool is. That's you know, getting this fire going, but it ain't burning very long. Do you care if someone says, well, I used to love you? Do you care? Well, I used to love you. Who cares? Matter of fact, those are foolish words. Like, I don't even want to hear them. Nobody cares if you used to do anything. I've heard that said. I used to love you. You're just a fool. Your fire just went out. Yeah. You're a fool. You're just foolish. You're just immature. Why? Because the truth is, we choose to look at sin. Offenses, hard times, problems, issues, concerns. I have now waxed cold. I got a buddy of mine, hasn't talked to his brother in 20 years. We were talking about this as the holidays were coming up, and I'm thinking to myself, of course, I got to encourage him. I'm like, well, make the call, man. Or just send him like a little gift in the mail. Send him like a fruit basket or something. Like, if you just get the ball rolling. Like, just get the ball rolling and God will figure it out. My heart broke for him because he's a good friend of mine. I'm like, man, that shouldn't be. I got two brothers. What, you don't think we fight? We fight our whole life. We don't agree on stuff. I don't choose to look at the offense. Instead, I choose to love my brother. It's like that movie, The Life of Dan, you know, love is an ability. Love is an ability. It's my ability to love, not hold on to the offense, not hold on to the sin, not hold on to the problem. I choose to love them, not go 20 years and not talk to them. What? Brothers and sisters don't fight? Come on. Brothers and sisters fight. Family fights.
Folk will go years without talking to them over something so stupid. Or maybe it's big. It doesn't really matter, church. Your love waxed cold. If you have greater vision, if you have greater hearing, then the voice of heaven ought to say, I forgive you. Does that sound like the voice of heaven? I think it sounds like the voice of heaven. Like the voice from heaven wouldn't say, hey, don't forgive them. Like, is anybody thinking God's up there? No, don't. Whatever you do, don't forgive them. That's a fool, man. You a fool. It makes no sense.
Go down to verse 9. Be not hasty in thy spirit and be angry, for anger resteth in the bosom of fools. And that's why, because I'll get angry at you over something stupid instead of choosing to love you. Or again, maybe it's big. I don't know. Maybe it's, you want to know what big is? Hey, I'll define your big. Who for the joy before him endured the cross. The Roman soldier that put the very nails in his hands, it was joy that was before him. He endured the cross. He chose to love him. Do you think Jesus Christ's love waxed cold for that Roman soldier? Of course not. It's not even possible. It's not even possible. He didn't get angry at him. No, the angry one's the fool. Ain't that true, though? You ever get, like, I mean, come on, church. Unfortunately, I got to admit to you, at times I've gotten angry. I realize I'm a fool. What in the world is that? The emotions, they're just, they'll wreak havoc.
Say not thou, what is the cause that the former days were better than these? For thou dost not inquire wisely concerning this.
Listen, you need all kinds of days. You need good days, bad days. You need up days, down days. You need sideways days. You need confused days. Every day you got, you need it. It'll do something to you. It'll bring about the change. God needs every day. Because there are certain days we don't want. Maybe you say, thank God 2019 is God. You needed 2019, church. I don't know what 2020 holds. You need it. How much of it? All 365. You need them all, church. You don't inquire wisely if you think you can say, that was a bad day. And the reason that's why I don't talk to my brother, because of that bad day. Oh, no. I wax cold because of the bad day. No, you need them all, Phil. Stop it. Go talk to your brother. Send him a fruit basket. I did send him a fruit basket this year. I think, was there fruit in there? Uncle Eddie sent fruit. And it's because I love him I sent the fruit, not because we weren't talking, just so there's no confusion.
Wisdom is good with an inheritance, and by it there is profit to them that see the sun. For wisdom is defense, and money is defense, but the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it.
You can't have life without wisdom. You can't have this Christ life without wisdom.
And unfortunately, that word money, it's a bad translation of the Hebrew word. It's actually talking about silver, it's speaking of redemption. Because in it, and that's essentially what these five things of wisdom are. And really, where is the wisdom? James says that the wisdom that is from above is faith.
Not natural wisdom, not me studying. I read my Bible, church, that won't give me wisdom. Wisdom that is from above. Matter of fact, James says, wisdom that is from above, the first it is pure. The very first thing it is pure. So then why am I seeing sin? Why am I seeing problems? My Bible says I'm supposed to see a sun. The Beatles song, right? Here comes the sun, do-do-do-do. It's all right. I don't see storm clouds, church. I see a sun. Even though there may be a storm, I don't see a storm. I see a sun. Why? Because wisdom is from above. The very first thing it is pure. I'm not confused about what's going on in my life.
I understand it. And that's when we take our eyes off of God, we take our eyes off the sun, then we see the storm. We don't see the faith from it. Remember when Peter sank? When he came out of the boat, Jesus says, hey, Jesus told him to come. Right? We say, oh, he had the faith to get out. No, Jesus told Peter to get out of the boat. He told him to come. Peter was obedient first. But it says he saw the wind. When he saw the wind, he began to sink. How do you see wind? What did he see? Because what you see is really not real. The natural circumstances, the storms, the trials, and all that in your life, you see that, you sink. But if you keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, then maybe, just maybe, you won't sink. He saw the wind. What are you looking at the wind for? Don't look at the wind. Look at Jesus. Don't look at the storm. Just look at Jesus. Look at the sun. You understand what I'm saying, church? Because that's the wisdom. The wisdom is, because you can't attain wisdom, church. You can't. He talks about this in Ecclesiastes. The wisest man says, you can't get there. It's only by faith, by believing and trusting in God. That's the wisdom. That will make you wise. Faith makes you wise. Believing, trusting in God makes you wise. Amen? Consider the work of God. For who can make straight which he hath made crooked? And again, I believe what we're talking about here, it's our mouth. It's the words we speak that are crooked. Because he says that in Ecclesiastes 1, that what's already, whatever is crooked, that which has been spoken, you can't straighten it out. So how do I fix this? Well, you got to make straight. Didn't Jesus say that too? Or actually, John, I'm sorry. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the way, make straight his path. What's his path? Heaven. If I keep my eyes on heaven, then maybe the words I will speak will be the voice of heaven. Amen? They won't be twisted. They won't be crooked. They won't be perverted. Perverted just means a bend, a crooked, you know. And that's when the road ain't straight. If everyone looks up, we all see the same thing, amen? It's heaven. It's straight. But then it ought to produce the right voice, amen? It ought to produce the voice of heaven. I think it's Philippians that says that too. This is, he said, be blameless and harmless, sons of God, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. What's he saying? You can't blame people. You can't harm people. He's talking about the way we speak to one another. When we blame people for my storm, anybody ever blame somebody for their storm besides the pastor? That's not a son of God. That's actually a son of the devil. The devil will blame people for their storm. The devil will harm people because of the storm, because then I will harm you. Look what you did to me. And then whatever I choose to say about you. But now you're crooked. You're not straight. You're supposed to be blameless. You're supposed to be harmless. I don't even know how we confuse that word. What does that mean? Don't blame people. Doesn't he also say that? Let no corrupt communication come out of your mouth, but only that which will edify the hearer. Well, who's hearing it? I don't know. Who are you talking to? Let no corrupt communication. Maybe you got to be the voice of heaven instead of what? The voice of the other place. We got to make straight his path. How do we make straight? It's the words that we declare to one another. We will only speak the words of Christ. We will only speak that which will edify. We only speak of love. We only speak of forgiveness. This is the voice of the one crying in the wilderness. And he says, what? Get me out of the wilderness. Get me into heaven. How do you get out of the wilderness and get into heaven? You just got to speak as Christ would speak. And quit, you know, blaming people and telling people that they're no good or they're sin or whatever else. That's not the voice of heaven, church. In the day of prosperity, be joyful. But in the day of adversity, consider. God also hath set one over against the other, to the end that man should find nothing after him. What is he saying there? Listen, both sides. And when it's all said and done, consider it. What do you find, God? I only find God. I quit blaming you. I quit harming you. And I find God. In what? In my prosperity and in my adversity. I find God. You need both, church. It's two sides to the coin. I mean, that's the truth. But you find God.
You quit blaming everybody else, and you realize that it's just God working in your life. Amen. Be not righteous over much, neither make thyself over wise. Why should thy destroy thyself? What's he saying? Don't be extreme. Because sometimes we gotta go to the extremes. Oh, you're not in church enough. You're not praying enough. You're not this enough. You're not enough. There's never enough. Again, it's just a straight path. You don't gotta go too far to the left. Don't go too far to the right. Just go straight. No extremes. Why does it gotta be so extremes? And sometimes we do. There are extremes either way. Now, sometimes I do it because I want to serve God and I love God. But I think you lose folks when you go to the extremes. Don't you lose folks when you go to the extremes? I don't think we're supposed to go to these extremes. Be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why should thou die before thy time? So now he's telling you, why should you die before the time? And why? He's saying right there, because you're wicked and you're foolish. You know, David said this, and I think in Psalms he said that the Lord will preserve the stranger and the fatherless and the widow. But the way of the wicked he shall turn upside down. So God's going to save the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. But the wicked, the way of the wicked. He didn't say he was going to destroy the wicked. The way. What is the way? It's just me living a natural life and not understanding that I got to have greater vision and keep my eyes on Christ. Keep my eyes on heaven and maybe declare the goodness of heaven. And instead, I become this fool. So he's got to turn my world upside down. Bang. Because I'm living a natural life. He says, nope, I want you to live in heaven. Bang. He turns you upside down. Remember that Diana Ross song? Upside down, you're turning me. You're giving love instinctively. Why does he turn you upside down? Because he loves you. He gives his love instinctively. It's just his instincts to love you. Imagine that. Can we love like that? Where it's just your instincts? Your first reaction is to do what? Love. Oh, boy. I got work to do on that one, church. But I want to. He turns it upside down. And who are we talking about? The stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. What are we talking? We're just talking about the world. I'm a stranger, right? Aren't we sojourners in this land? I don't live in the world. The world ain't mine. The world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. And then I'm fatherless. What are we talking about there? I'm an orphan. Okay? I have no identity with the world. The world is not my identity. Like if you see my dad, you say, hey, you look like your pop. Right, there's identity, my natural father. Again, you got to look at this spiritually. And even Jesus Christ himself, Joseph wasn't his father. Who was his father? God. Was he an orphan? We're all orphans. to the world. It's a picture to show you to the world. That's not your identity. Because sometimes you say you got to fit in someplace, right? No, just me. I got to fit in here. In this, it could be a denomination. It could be a party affiliation. It could be your financial status in life. I'm middle class. No, I'm upper class. No, I'm lower class. You're none of the above. When it comes to the world, check the last box. None of the above. You're none of it. You're an orphan. There's no identity in that. Your only identity is in Christ. Christ Jesus. Because then that's what unites us all. You see? That's a party affiliation we can all join in. Hey! That sounds like the voice of heaven to me. And the widow, listen, you're dead to the world. You're just dead. You're a widow. Remember, Ruth married Boaz. She was a widow. Amen? What happened? She died to the world. We talked about that a few weeks ago. Moab died. It died. I'm no longer married to it. You see, because that's when the Bible's talking about unfaithful. You're unfaithful to God. Why? Because I want the world. He's not talking about marriage and divorce. Divorce the world, man. He's not telling you to divorce your spouse. Come on, man. It's craziness. It's kooky talk. When these pastors and preachers preach that, it drives me nuts. Divorce from the world, man. I won't live any other way. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives within me. And John actually talked about this too. We actually
We think we gotta sound like the world. No, you don't. He said, ye speak the world. Does anybody speak the world? Yes. When you think you've got to fit in, you speak the world. There's nothing about a life of faith that speaks the world, okay? Jesus of Nazareth, he was a Nazarite. He was the separate one. I don't cut my hair. I don't drink. I don't shave. I'm not like everybody else. We got to fit in. No, you don't. No, you don't. I got to look like the world. They won't accept me. They may not. They're not supposed to accept you, though. They're supposed to accept Christ, not the world. We want to look like the world. I don't want to look like the world. I don't want to sound like the world. I don't want to be the world. I don't want nothing to do with it. I'm not talking about people. I'm not talking about people. I'm talking about ideas, precepts, beliefs, concepts. That's what I'm talking about. It has no place in my life because God preserves all those. The wicked, he just turns upside down. Why? So you'll become the stranger, the fatherless, the widow. Now, you wouldn't want to necessarily join that club, but you're, again, this is the oxymoron. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Amen? Let's look at verse 21 here. Also, take no heed unto all words that are spoken, lest thou hear thy servant curse thee. When people say things to you, sometimes they say it in haste, like that angry spirit. Don't listen to it. Right away we listen. Can you believe what they said? Actually, I don't believe what they said. I don't care what they say. How's that? The world does. Come on, man. The world will spar over words all day, every day. What's tomorrow's war is going to be over? I don't know. Let's see what the words are, and then we'll figure out what they're going to fight over tomorrow. Don't take it personal, man. People of faith cannot take things personal. When you take it personal, what you say is, I don't have faith. I'm now letting my feelings control me. If you're taking it personal, it's because feelings took over, not faith. When faith takes over, it says, all right. I mean, I don't have to like it. But I don't have to lose my mind over it. You see? I can still be as Christ and let no corrupt communication come out of my mouth. Didn't he say that? That your speech should always be with grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer every man, like maybe the one that's railing you? Well, let me speak with words of grace and season it with salt. That's the sacrifice. So I know how to answer every man. Don't take it personal, church. Faith doesn't take it personal. Now, it'll take time, because sometimes we're just reactionary. What? You said what? That's what he said, Jesus. Don't look at the wind. Look up. Help me, Lord Jesus. Verse 24. That which is far off and exceeding deep, who can find it out? What are you talking about, deep? The things of God. I thought of the woman at the well when I read that verse. That's what I thought of. How can I draw it out? It's the wellspring of life that's inside of you and I. It's the Christ. It's that. By the way, this it's supposed to be a wellspring. It's supposed to come out. People are supposed to be able to drink from it. How do you drink from that well? Well, the only way they can drink from the well, you got to be preaching and teaching acceptable words. Words that they will actually receive and accept. If I call you a sinner, that well has now produced, you know, a bitter water. You're not going to want that. If I say you're no good, or if I say you're this, or if I say you're that, that is not the wellspring of life. You got to go deep. How do I go deep? I go deeper with God. God will continue to reveal these things. Doesn't he say that his riches are unsearchable? How do you get them? He reveals them to you. He just shows you. There's this awakening. Verse 27. Behold, this I found, saith the preacher, counting one by one, to find out the account. What's Solomon saying here? He found something. He found something. He found, what do you think he found? He found the Christ that was inside of himself. That's what he found.
But I love it. Who found it?
Preacher found it. King didn't find it. Wise man didn't find it. Rich man didn't find it. The preacher found it. The preacher found it. How did he find it? Because he realizes now it's the words that he speaks. It's how he speaks to people and how he treats people. He realizes it's the Christ that's inside of him. It's not supposed to be reflected. It's not with these outward things. It's not that I've got to be the king. It's not that I've got to be the smartest. It's not that I've got to be the richest. I found it. I found it. Where did he find it? He had to find it inside himself. It's the same place you and I find it. What, he found it in a different spot than you and I? Of course not. The preacher found it. How many want to be a preacher?
I think I'll sign up for that now.
The preacher found it. How? Because we declare this. We speak it. It's the voice of heaven. It's the voice of heaven, amen? And how did he do it? One by one. You need them all, church. Doesn't he say that in Isaiah? Line upon line, precept upon precept. You need them all. You need them all. They just, you build. It's just God working in our life, amen?
Which yet my soul seeketh, but I find not. One man among a thousand have I found.
There it is. He found the one man. It's the Christ man. It's the only one that matters.
Amen? But a woman among all those have I not found.
See, my woman, it's not in the woman. You can't find it in the woman. We're talking about the soul of man. We're talking about our emotions. We're talking about our feelings. Whoa, feelings. You won't find Christ in there. Where will you find him?
In faith.
In faith. In this ability to love that will hold on to Christ. You see, because if you're holding on to Christ, I believe you can love like that. I believe you may have to endure the cross, but you'll still see joy. I believe that.
But it's the one man.
The preacher finds it. How do I? I find it because I declare the words of Christ. I will only speak of his goodness, of his kindness, of his love. It's a voice from heaven. You got to make straight the path. Make straight the path.